In the dark shadows, in the white cold, fearlessly we search for knowledge new and old. We drink the strong spirits and read ancient tomes, the order of the Abracast. We are the brave and bold.
Studios presents The Jinn Jihad. The Jinn Jihad kicks your face with myths, mysteries, epic battles, suicide bombers, quirky characters, and divine power armor. In this epic graphic novel, the warrior archangels descend on a city in chaos. It's all-out war. The non-standard assembly battles an ancient terrorist organization. And their ultimate weapon, a corrupted, magically enhanced, unstoppable monster, the Jinn. This graphic novel is a wild ride. It's one part distant Arab myth, one part Old Testament angelic vengeance, and one part unique heroic tough guys. Available on Amazon. Get more info on the Jinn Jihad and other titles at stigmatastudios.com.
The Abracast. Occult. History. Conspiracy. Violence.
All right, welcome to the Abracast. This is your home slice, John Towers. Thank you guys for tuning in. I appreciate it. I love everybody. Thank you so much for giving me the opportunity to talk about these weird subjects to somebody, so I'm not just sitting here babbling to myself. Got a lot of stuff to cover and a lot of like pre stuff also. So obviously I want to encourage everyone to rate and review on iTunes. Check out my Patreon account, please. Please also check out the website stigmatastudios.com or abracast.com. It's important because it has links to all my social media accounts right there at the bottom, so you can find me. It's important because there's a featured topics link there. So instead of me rattling off or trying to remember all the episodes that this topic relates to, you just go to that feature topics link and get a list right there, or you can listen to them streaming right from the website. So, want to bring that to everybody's attention. Also, weird kind of personal sort of thing. As soon as I can get my fucking phone, All right, I've been recording these episodes out of order for various logistical reasons. Anyway, this is the closest I could get to actually delivering the message on time. So, you know, when you look at my life from the outside, I live my life pretty much like a 14-year-old boy. I draw comic books all day. I do a podcast once or twice a week. And, up until pretty recently, I was also an independent professional wrestler. So it's like, what is an independent professional wrestler? Like, you know how WWE is sports entertainment? Independent wrestling is, independent pro wrestling is like what wrestling used to be. If you've never been to an indie wrestling show, they're everywhere. There, you can find them if you're near a medium to small city. They're literally, they're everywhere. If you've never been to an indie wrestling show, I so encourage it. It is so much fun, and there's so many talented people. Anyhow, if you're in the Pittsburgh, West Virginia, Cleveland area, this tri-state sort of area, then on September 2nd, we're going to make indie wrestling history. There is a over 100 man over the top rope battle royal that's going on. It's going to be multiple rings, over 100 people, the most talented guys in the area are coming in to do it. So even though I've been out of wrestling for quite a long time, I wanted to take part in this, and luckily I knew enough people to where I could pull the strings. So it's going to be a multi-promotion, multi-state, multi-promotion event. And then after the Battle Royal, the Guinness Books of World Records people are going to be there. Actually, I don't know how it works. They might not be there, but there's some way to audit it, and we're gonna be in the Guinness Book of World Records for the over the top rope battle royal, the biggest one, I guess. And then after that match is gonna be first, and then after that they're doing a multi promotion show. They're having like the biggest. Super heavyweight match, like dudes over 6-7 feet or something. I don't know the deal behind it, but I am taking part in the over the top rope 100 man battle royal. So if you guys are in the area and you'd like to check it out, there's a Facebook page for it. I'm sure you can find it other places. It's at 1695 Marshall Street, Brentwood, West Virginia. So I will be there. I actually had to buy new wrestling boots to go, because when I quit, I gave my wrestling boots away. I gave both pairs of my wrestling boots away, because I was like, if I have wrestling boots sitting around the house, I'm going to want to wrestle in them. However, I'm not going to this thing as a scrub, you know, with some fucking Skechers and some kick pads or something, you know. So I went and I bought some new wrestling boots today. So I'm happy. I'm glad. I can't wait till they get here. So I can see them. And everyone's probably like, are you going to talk about Nimrod and Tammuz or what? Are we going to sit around talking about fucking indie wrestling all day long? But listen, bros, I'm super excited about these boots. They're black with red wingtips. They're going to be sweet. And they're going to match the Abracast t-shirt that I'm going to be sporting as well. Black and red, that's where it's at. So at the end of this episode, instead of the staple, instead of Soda Jerk's fucking fight, we're going to introduce a band called Saturn's Machine. They have a song called April's Child, and Saturn's Machine is awesome. And you can find them on Instagram, which is how they found me. Their artwork is great. And if you're familiar with my graphic novel, The Ages, you will know exactly what is going on with their imagery, because we were really connected. I actually sent them a free copy of the book so they could check it. Because I'm like, look, yo, I have a whole chapter in my book about Saturn being like this avatar for Jehovah or Elohim or God or whatever, and they're like, I really like to see that. So in case I don't get to it at the end, because we have a lot to talk about, so in case I forget, their link to their YouTube. The video is going to be in the show notes. It's called April's Child by Saturn Machine. And it says, April's Child is a chaotic melodrama about a young woman born in the month of April, caught between Aries and Mars. She spirals out of control, causing disaster at every turn. Saturn Machine are a new wave occult British psychedelic grunge rock band that creates a sound described as war gaze. So you'll like it. I think if you're a fan of the show, it fits right in with the kind of stuff we talk about. And actually, the last episode, we mentioned Nimrod being a stand-in force or being an originator of the god Saturn. So there we go. There's the link. All right, I hope I didn't ramble too long. Let's get into this thing here. Hold on. Before we go any further, I forgot I do have one more thing to fucking talk about. I got a 5-star review on the iTunes, so I love that. Sam's Willie 14 says, love this podcast. Talks about a wide variety of esoteric topics and has a unique way of doing so. Exclamation point. And he's got me drinking gin jihad as well, LOL. So yes, I do find that review helpful. Thank you very much, iTunes. And thank you very much, Sam's Willie 14. I appreciate it. In honor of Sam's Willie's 14's 5-star review, I want all of you people to get your mason jars out. And if you support me on Patreon, there is an opportunity for you to get the official Abercast mason jar with the oath printed on it. It's going to be sweet. Fill it with ice. Cut a lime slice. Sometimes it's not logistically possible to keep all these limes in the house all the time. And you can only winter soldier them for so long. That's what I call it. It's where you freeze. Like, you're done for the night, so you freeze your mason jar with the lime in there. And then when you mix your drink the next day, you know, the lime thaws out or whatever and is able to get in there and do its thing. You know, that only lasts for so long. And it's not sometimes logistically feasible to keep all these limes laying around the house. So, also, I would recommend, if that's the case for you, you get those little plastic limes full of lime juice. Do that. Do like 2 shots of gin in there, fill the cheapest gin, if they have the sub bottom shelf, that's the gin you want to go for. Like, it might, if your vessel wasn't blessed, if you didn't put a spell on your vessel, your mason jar, the cheapness of the gin might eat through the vessel. Fill the rest up with some kind of tonic water. Stir it up with some kind of chopstick or your finger or a knife. And there you go. You have your gin jihad. Okay, so we're going to continue on our talk about the two Babylons, or papal worship proved to be the worship of Nimrod and his wife. This was originally published in 1916. By Alexander Hislop. This is a part 2. I saw that they have a 7th edition on Amazon. I almost grabbed it, but I didn't. Because I had to pay for fucking wrestling boots. You know what I'm saying? It's weird. Wrestling boots are super expensive. And I don't think they don't cost like that much to make. I think it's like a business. I think it's like a suit that you wear for your interview at your job, because, you know, the suit costs more. Like, there's a gigantic markup on the suit, but at the same time, it's a commodity because it shows people that you're fucking to be taken seriously, right? It shows people that you take yourself seriously. You know, that's why I didn't want to show up to this thing. You know, 100+ workers, you know, and some fucking kick pads, because I gave my old boots away when I stopped wrestling. Nope. I know, you know, there's a modicum of some kind of respect in that community. I needed to I need to represent, especially because I'm going to be wearing a shirt about the podcast. I'm going to be wearing the Abercast t-shirt. So check on the website because I should have it done soon. So if you want to check it out, check out the shirt. I'll put a link to it on the website somewhere. That's abercast.com or stigmatastudios.com. Okay, enough of this wrestling stuff. Okay, we're going to get into Chapter 2, Section 2, Subsection 5, The Deification of the Child. Now, remember what I said about this book is it's dense. And every couple paragraphs or so, there's footnotes and explanations inset, and it gets real cumbersome to read. So what I need you to do is just take your hand off the wheel a little bit and let me guide you through this book. Chapter 2, Section 2, Subsection 5, The Deification of the Child. Now, God, I feel like that was a false start. So basically, if you haven't listened to the first episode, basically what this is, it's positing that at the time that God confounded the speech at the Tower of Babel, everyone was worshiping the king of Babel, or Babylon, who is Nimrod, and his son, who was Tammuz, and his wife, who was Sariamus. And once the speech got confounded or got confused, each of the tribes that scattered because of this, each one of them created or used their new language to design or to deify these people that were theoretically historical figures. So you see that this trinity is echoed throughout all these different cultures and all these different mythologies. And so Hislop here is making the case. He's going to the paint with it, by the way. He's armed and loaded for bear, making this case that the Catholic Church, the Trinity that they are worshiping, is actually Nimrod, Sariamus, and Tammuz. The Egyptian mythology with Osiris, Isis, and Horus is actually Nimrod, Tammuz, and Sariamus. The Balder the Brave is actually, you know, the Viking myth, the Norse myth, the anyhow, we're going to get into it. That's the thing, because it's weird, because I look at the numbers and I see that some people will listen to part one more than they will listen to part two, or they'll listen to part two more than they'll listen to part one. And like, if you're listening to part two, why wouldn't you listen to part one? Like, the numbers should kind of match, or at least the part two should have less numbers. I don't know. So in case you haven't checked it out, that's the cliff notes for it. Okay, finally. If there was one who was more deeply concerned with the tragic death of Nimrod than the other, it was his wife, Sariamus, who, from an originally humble position, had been raised to share with him the throne of Babylon. What, in this emergency, shall she do? Shall she quietly forego the pomp and the pride of which she has been raised? No. Although the death of her husband has given a rude shock to her power, yet her resolution and unbounded ambition were in no wise checked. On the contrary, her ambition took a still higher flight. In life, her husband had been honored as a hero. In death, she will have him worshipped as a god, yea, as the woman's promised seed, Zoroastra. This is also Zoroaster, who was destined to bruise the serpent's head. Who wasn't doing so was to have his own heel bruised. The patriarchs in the ancient world in general were perfectly acquainted with the grand primeval promise of Eden. And they knew right well that the bruising of the heel of the promised seed implied his death. and that the curse could be removed from the world only by the death of the Grand Deliverer, if the promise about the bruising of the serpent's head recorded in Genesis as made to our first parents were actually made, and if all of mankind were descended from them, then it might be expected to some trace of this promise would be found in all nations, and such, in fact, and such is the fact. So he goes on to quote a bunch of hero serpent myths. Apollo slaying Pytho, Hercules strangling the serpents in his cradle, Horus spearing these snake entities, Vishnu and Krishna, Thor finally killing the Midgard serpent, only to die by the venom of the monster, and then, of course, Perseus and Medusa. He doesn't actually mention Perseus and Medusa. I threw that in. Going back to the book, in meaning of the representation had been generally lost, although when viewed in this light of scripture, it is surely deeply significant. A human figure whelmed to toil appears, yet still with a name uncertain he remains, nor known the labor that thus sustains. But this upon his knees, he seems to fall, him ignorant mortals. Oh boy, Aegonius call. And while sublime his awful hands are spread, beneath him rolls the dragon's horrid head. And his right foot unmoved appears to the constellation thus represented as commonly known by the name the Kneeler. I believe it's Hercules. I believe it's also known as Hercules. From this very description of the Greek poet, but it is plain that as Eugonasis, how did I pronounce it before? Eugonasis? Maybe. Came from the Babylonians, it must be interpreted not in Greek but in Chaldean sense. And such interpreted as the actions of the figure itself implies. The title of the mysterious sufferer is called the serpent crusher. Sometimes, however, the actual crushing of the serpent was represented as a much more easy process. Yet even then, death was the ultimate result, and the death of the serpent destroyer is so described as to leave no doubt whence this fable was borrowed. In the legend, it comes from him, the whole, the primeval promise. In Eden, it is very strikingly embodied. First, he is represented in pictures and images with his foot on the great serpent's head, and then after destroying it, he is fabled to have died in consequence of being shot by an arrow in the foot. And, as is the case of Tammuz, great lamentations were annually made for his death. Even in Greece, also the classic story of Paris and Achilles, because of his foot, we have a very plain allusion that part of the primeval promise, which is referred to as the bruising of the conqueror's heel. Achilles was the only son of a goddess. Was invulnerable in all points except for his heel. But there was a deadly wound. At this, his adversary took aim, and his death was a result. If there be such evidence still that even pagans knew that it was by dying that the promised Messiah was to destroy death and him and his power of death, that is the devil. How much more vivid must his impression of mankind in general in regarding to this vital death in the early days of Seriamus, when there was so much nearer to the fountainhead of all these divine traditions? The book goes on to say, it seems to have been only now when the dead hero was to be deified that the secret mysteries were set up. The previous form of apostasy during the life of Nimrod appears to have been open and public. Now it was evidently felt that publicity was out of the question. The death of our great ringleader of the apostasy was not the death of a warrior slain in battle, but the act of judicial rigor. Solemnly inflicted. This is well established by the accounts of the deaths of both Tammuz and Osiris. The following is the account of Tammuz given by the celebrated Maimonides, deeply read in all the learnings of Chaldeans. Quote, when the false prophet named Tammuz preached to a certain king that he should worship the seven stars and the 12 signs of the zodiac, this king ordered him to be put to a terrible death. And on the night of his death, all the images assembled from the ends of the earth to the temple of Babylon, to the great golden image of the sun, which now suspended between heaven and earth. The image prostrated itself in the midst of the temple, and so did all the images around it, while it related to them all that had happened to Tammuz. The image wept and lamented all night long, and in the morning they flew away, each to his own temple, again in the ends of the earth, and hence rose the custom every year on the first day of the month, Tammuz, to mourn and weep for Tammuz. There he is, of course, all the extravagance of idolatry, as found in the Chaldean sacred books that Maimonides had consulted. But there is no reason to doubt the fact stated either as to the manner or cause of death of Tammuz. It is this Chaldean legend, it is stated that it was the command of a certain king that this ringleader in apostasy was put to death. Who could this king be, who was so determinedly opposed to the worship of the host of heaven? Who was related to the Egyptian Hercules? We get very valuable light on the subject. It is omitted that most of the ancient Hercules and truly primitive one, who he was known in Egypt as having the power of gods, fought against to overcome the giants. This also links back to Nimrod, who hunted and killed the giants. And some people, I mean, we talked about it in the Tower of Babel episode, that Rob Skiba talks about that he went through ritual high magic and experiments to try to turn himself into a giant, biological experiments, sexual rituals to turn himself into a giant. Man, that was a wild episode. Wow. Now, back to the book. Now, no doubt the title and character of, I keep saying Hercules, but I should say Heracles, right? Yeah, there is a difference, bro. Now, no doubt the title and character of Heracles were a foreword given to the pagans to him whom they worshipped as the grand deliverer or messiah, just as the adversaries of the pagan divinities came to be stigmatized as giants who rebelled against heaven. But let the reader only reflect who were the real giants that rebelled against heaven. They were Nimrod and his party, for the giants were just the mighty ones of whom Nimrod was the leader. Now, then was most likely to head the opposition to the apostasy from this primitive worship. And then there was the primitive Heracles, who overcame the giants. And not by mere physical force, but by the power of God, or the influence of the Holy Spirit, that entirely agrees with his character. And more than that, it remarkably agrees to the Egyptian account to the death of Osiris. The Egyptians say the grand enemy of their god overcame him. Not by open violence, but having entered into a conspiracy with 72 of the leading men of Egypt. He got him into power put him to death, and then cut his dead body into pieces and sent the different parts to so many different cities throughout the country. The real meaning of this statement will appear if we glance at the judicial institutions of Egypt. 72 was just the number of the judges, both civil and sacred, who, according to the Egyptian law, were required to determine that was to be punished of one guilty of so high an offense as that of Osiris. Supposing this to have become a matter of judicial inquiry, in determining such a case, there were necessarily two tribunals concerned. First, there was the ordinary judges who had power of life and death and who amounted to 30. There was over and above a tribunal consisting of 42 judges who, if Osiris was condemned to die, had to determine whether his body should be buried or no for before burial. Everyone after the death had to pass this ordeal of this tribunal. As burial was refused to him, both tribunals would necessarily be concerned, and thus there would be exactly 72 persons under Typho, the president, to condemn Osiris to die and to be cut into pieces. What then does this statement account to in regarding to the conspiracy, but just to this, that the great opponent of the idolatrous system which Osiris introduced had so convinced these judges of the enormity of this offense which he had committed, that they gave up the offender to an awful death as terror to anyone might afterwards tread in his steps. The cutting of the dead body into pieces and sending the dismembered parts among the different cities is paralleled and its object explained by what we read in the Bible of the cutting of the dead body of Levite's concubine into pieces. Judges 19 to 29, they're sending one of the body parts to the 12 tribes of Israel. All right, so this also has a parallel, you can see, to the conspiracy to crucify Jesus. It is admittedly the commenter that Levite acted on a patriarchal custom according to which summary vengeance would be dealt to those who failed to come to the gathering that in this solemn way was summoned. It was declared in so many words by Saul that when the parts of the slaughtered oxen were sent to the tribes, whosoever cometh not forth after Saul and after Samuel, so shall it be done to his oxen. So we're just going to skip ahead a little bit. They are talking about the blah, 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 Typho. The influence that is aboard Typho wielded over the minds of the so-called conspirators, considering that the physical force with which Nimrod was upheld must have been wonderful, and goes to show that through this deed in regarding to Osiris is veiled and himself branded by a hateful name, he was indeed none other than the primitive Hercules or Heracles that overcame the giants by the power of God, by this persuasive might of the Holy Spirit. In connection with this character, of Shem, the myth that makes Adonis into who is identified with Osiris perish by the tusks of the wild boar is easily unraveled. The tusk of the wild boar was a symbol in scripture. A tusk called a horn among many of the classic Greeks was regarded in the same light. When once it is known that a tusk is regarded as a horn, according to the symbolism of idolatry, the meaning of the boar's tusk by which Adonis perished is not far to seek. The bull's horns that Nimrod wore were the symbol of physical power. The boar's tusk were a symbol of spiritual power. As a horn means power, so a tusk is a horn in the mouth, means power in the mouth. In other words, the power of persuasion. Skipping ahead now, how is this mourning Heracles represented as putting down the enormities and the redressing of wrongs, not by his club like the Heracles of the Greeks, but by the force of persuasion. Multitudes were represented in following him, drawn by fine chains of gold and amber inserted into their ears, in which the chains proceeded from his mouth. There is a great difference between the two symbols of the tusk of the boar and the golden chains issuing from the mouth. The drawling will crowds by the ears. That drawling, willing crowd by the ears, but both very beautifully illustrate the same idea, the might of the persuasive power. Phineas had evidently come to the same substantial conclusion before him. He maintains, from the evidence open to him in his day, that it was Nimrod that established the sciences of magic and astronomy. Now, the secret system of the mysteries gave vast facilities for imposing on the senses of the initiated by means of the various tricks and artifices of magic. Notwithstanding are the care and precautions of those who constructed these initiations, although enough has transpired to give us a clear insight to their real character. Everything was so contrived as the wind up the mind, or sorry, to, as to wind up the minds of the novices to the highest pitch of excitement. There, after having surrendered themselves implicitly to the priest, they might have prepared or received anything after the candidates for the initiations had passed through the confessional and sworn the required oaths. Strange and amazing objects presented themselves, sometimes from places that were, seemed to shake around them. Sometimes it appeared brightest and resplendent with life and radiant fire. And then again covered with black darkness, sometimes thunder and lightning, sometimes frightful noises and bellowing, sometimes that. All right, we're just going to jump ahead a little bit. We're getting back into this. The scheme thus skillfully formed took effect, and Ceriamus gained the glory from her dead and deified husband, and of course at the same time, both of them, under the names of Rhea and Nin, or goddess, mother, and son, were worshipped. Goes on to say, even in Babylon itself, the posthumous child, as identified with his father and inheriting all his father's glory, yet possessing more of his mother's complexion. This book gets deep into this racial thing. So this talk of complexion is actually they're pointing out basically that Tammuz was mixed, or that Ceriamus was of a pale complexion. They find a lot of things that mention that her or her like kind of avatars or whatever are blonde, and they really talk about Nimrod being black. And I'm not going to get into all of that. I find that it's pointless. I find that it's pointless, and I also find that it's distracting. So even in Babylon itself, the posthumous child, as identified with his father and inheriting all his father's glory, yet possessing more of his mother's complexion, came to be the favorite type of the Madonna's divine son. This son, thus worshipped in his mother's arms, was looked upon as invested with the attributes and called by almost all the names of the promised Messiah. As God in the Hebrew of the Old Testament, as Adonai, the Lord, so Tammuz was called Odon or Adonis. Under the name of Mithras, he was worshipped as mediator or mediator and head of the covenant of grace. He was styled as Baal Bereth, Lord of the Covenant in Judges 8:33. In character, he was represented in Persian monuments as seated on the rainbow, as a well-known symbol of the covenant. Remember, this whole thing is literally tied into the flood myth. It's a sequel of the flood myth. In India, under the name of Vishnu, the preserver or savior of men, although a god, he was worshipped as a great victim man who, before the worlds were because... the worlds were because there was nothing else to offer. He offered himself as a sacrifice. Do any marvel at such statements being found in the sacred books of a pagan mythology? Why should they? Since sin entered the world, there has been only one way of salvation, and that was through the blood of the everlasting covenant. A way that all mankind once knew from the days of the righteous Abel, when Abel by faith offered unto Cain, or offered under, I got Cain on my brain. I wrote a book about him. It's called The Ages. You can find it on Amazon or on my website. Offered unto God his more excellent sacrifice than that of Cain. It was his faith in the blood of the lamb slain in the purpose of God from the foundation of the world, and in due time to actually be offered up on Calvary and given all the excellence to his offering. From the clear vein, the immortal ichor flows, such streams issued as a wounded God, pure emanation, uncorrupted flood, unlike our gross, diseased, terrestrial blood. Now, what is the meaning of this term ichor, or ichor? I'm not sure how the best way to pronounce it. In Greek, it has no such etymological meaning, whatever. But in Chaldee, ichor signifies a precious thing. Such a name applied to the blood of divinity could only have one origin. It bears its evidence on its very face of it, as coming from the grand patriarchal tradition that led Abel to look forward to the precious blood of Christ and the most precious gift of my of that divine love to give to a guilty world, in which while the blood of only genuine victim man in as at its at the same time, indeed and in truth, the blood of God, Acts 20:28. Even in Greece itself, though, the doctrine was usually perverted. It was not entirely lost. It was mingled with falsehoods and fable. It was hid from the multitude, but yet the secret mystical system was necessarily occupied in important place. As Servius tells us, the grand purpose of the Bacchic orgies was the purification of souls. You'll see this in mythology and in these weird religious systems. And in, I swear we're going to do a sex magic series at some point in time, but you get the sin out of your body through your orgasm. The soul gets purified by the orgasm, and the body gets purified by the ejaculation. Oh boy, it's weird. Why do I know these things? And as these orgies were, this is why there were sacred prostitutes in the ancient world. They were basically, I guess you can kind of look at them as like sacrificial fucking, like they offered themselves up so you can get this sin out of your being. Get frog. And as these orgies, come on, paper will hold your structural integrity. And as in these orgies, there was regular and tearing asunder in the shedding of the blood of an animal in memory of the shedding of the life's blood of the great divinity commemorated in them. Could this symbolic shedding of blood of the divinity have a bearing to the purification from sin these mystic rites were intended to effect? We have seen the sufferings of these gods were expressly represented as voluntary and as submitted to the benefit of the world. And that in connection with the crushing of the great serpent's head, which implied the removal of sin and the curse, the Grecian Bacchus was just another form of the Babylonian divinity, that his sufferings and bloodshed must have been represented as having been undergone for the same purpose, for the purification of souls. From this point of view, let the well-known name of Bacchus in Greece be looked at. The name was Dionysus, or Dionysos. What is the meaning of that name? Hitherto, it has defied all interpretations, but deal with it as belonging to the language of the land which the god himself originally came, and the meaning is very plain. Dionysus signifies the sin bearer, a name entirely appropriate to the character of him suffering, were represented as so mysterious, and who was looked up to as the great purifier of souls. Dionysus is actually, when you look at these gods, like in, you know, this whole thing kind of part of this whole section of this kind of launched because of Zeitgeist, the beginning of Zeitgeist. And I don't know if they mentioned Dionysus as a pre-Christ figure at all, but I do. I look at Dionysus, and Dionysus is he inspires sacred madness, and he is a god of wine like Bacchus, right? So that on its face links him with Christ, as far as I'm concerned, with the turning water into wine and all of this stuff. Now, this Babylonian god, known in Greece as the sin bearer, and in India as the victim man among the Buddhists of the East, the original elements of whose system are clearly Babylonian, was commonly addressed to as the savior of the world. And it has been all along well enough known that the Greeks occasionally worshipped the supreme god under the title of Zeus the Savior. But this title was thought to have been a reference only to the deliverance in battle, or some suck-like temporal deliverance. But when it is known that Zeus the Savior was only a title of Dionysus, the sin-bearing Bacchus, this character as the Savior appears in quite a different light. In Egypt, the Chaldean god was held up as the great object of love and adoration. And as God, through whom the god of truth were revealed to mankind, goodness of truth was revealed to mankind, he was regarded as the predestined heir of all things. And on the day of his birth, it was believed that a voice was heard to proclaim, quote, "The Lord of all the earth is born," unquote. The character, he was styled the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. It is being professed and representative of his hero god that is celebrated. Sestrius caused this very title to be added to his name on the monuments which were erected to perpetuate the family of his victories. Not only was he honored for being the great world king, but is regarded as lord of the invisible world and judge of the dead. And it was taught that in the world of spirits, all must appear before his dread tribunal. Ooh, the judgment day, when the souls are weighed. to have their destiny assigned to them. All right, man, we're running late as shit. I talked too much wrestling at the beginning. Don't worry, though. I'm here towards the end. We're going to get through this. We're going to get through it, my friends. We're moving into Chapter 2, Section 3, The Mother of the Child. Now, while the mother derived her glory in the first instance from the divine character attributed to the child in her arms, the mother in the long run practically eclipsed the son. At first, there's some wordplay going on there. At first, in all likelihood, there would be no thought whatsoever of ascribing divinity to the mother. There was an express promise that necessarily led mankind to expect that some time or another the Son of God, in amazing condescension, should appear in this world as the Son of Man. But there was no promise whatever, or the least shadow of a promise, to lead anyone to anticipate that the woman should ever be invested with attributes that should raise her to a level of divinity. It is in the last degree improbable, therefore, that when the mother was first exhibited with the child in her arms, it should be intended to give divine honors to her. She was doubtless used chiefly as a pedestal for upholding the divine son, the holding him forth for the adoration of mankind, the glory enough it would be counted for her, alone with all of the daughters of Eve, to have given birth to the promised seed. This world's only hope. But while this, no doubt, was the design, it is a plain principle in all idolatries that which most appeals to the senses must make the most powerful impression. Now the sun, even in his new incarnation, when Nimrod was believed to have reappeared in a fairer form. Now we see this too. I'm only mentioning this because it links in with this figure that I found, this Harpocrates. As a regressed form of Horus, Horocorit. So we see that. We've seen this. We've run into this on the show before. That's all that I'm saying. Where the fuck was I? Believed to have reappeared in a fair form. It was exhibited merely as a child. Let me guess, he was a child with his finger over his lips riding a ram. go find the Harpocrates episodes. Or just go to the featured links tab. I'll try to remember to put them on there. Without any very particular attraction, while the mother in whose arms he was set off with all the art and the painting and the sculpture, was invested with much of that extraordinary beauty which in reality belonged to her. The beauty of Ceriamus is said on one occasion to have quelled a rising rebellion among her subjects, another sudden appearance among them. Skip ahead a little bit. The Babylonian queen was not merely in character coincident with Aphrodite of Greece, but of Venus of Rome, but was in point in fact the historical original of that goddess that by the ancient world was regarded as the very embodiment of everything attractive in the female form. Venus, rocket number 9, take off for the planet Venus. At the perfection of the female beauty here we go. I'm going to really fucking butcher this. Let me try to sound it out. The perfection of the female beauty for San Chuan Athon. San Chuan Athon I guess, ensures us that Aphrodite, or Venus, was identical with Astarte, and Astarte, we know this already, being interpreted as none other than the woman that makes the towers for encompassing walls, i.e. Sarianus. The Roman Venus was the Cyprian Venus, and the Venus of Cyprus is historically proved to be derived from the Hollywood Babylon. Now, what in these circumstances might have been expected actually took place. If the child was to be adored much more than the mother in point of fact became the favorite object of worship. Skipping ahead. Boy, running late as fuck. That the birth of the great deliverer was to be miraculous was widely known long before the Christian era. For centuries, some say for thousands of years before that event, the Buddhist priest had a tradition that a virgin would bring forth the child to bless the world. That there was a tradition came from a no popish or Christian source. Is evident from the surprise felt expressed by the Jesuit missionaries when they first entered Tibet and China, and not only found a mother and child worshipped at home, but that mother worshipped under the character exactly corresponding with that of their own Madonna, Virgo Dia Para, the Virgin Mother of God, and that too in regions where they could not find the least trace of either the name or history of the Lord Jesus Christ having ever been known. Only all power, but all grace, the goddess, grace and goodness were believed to dwell in the Virgin Mother. Every quality of gentleness and mercy was regarded as centered in her. And when death had closed her career, while she was fabled to have been deified and changed into a pigeon, to express the celestial benignity of this nature, she was called by the name of Delune, or the Dove, or without the article, Juno, the name of the Roman Queen of Heaven, which has the very same beginning and under the form of a dove is well known as her own. She was worshipped by the Babylonians. So this has a lot of shit attached to it. Like, we need to back up and talk about this at some other time because like I said, it's getting late. But so all of this pigeon dove stuff has come. I mentioned a few episodes ago that I was working on an episode about the American goddess Columbia, and some stuff about this Columbia has to do with doves. And as soon as I read that, I was like, oh my god, Columbia is Sariamus and Hammurabi. They have statues of Hammurabi, who is Nimrod, in Washington, D.C. And my conspiracy brain started going bananas. But so I'm just going to leave it at that. Obviously, what he's talking about, I don't know if he talks about it. Yeah, he does. Okay, so I'm just going to let him talk about it. Hold on. The dove, the chosen symbol of the deified queen, is commonly represented with an olive branch in her mouth, as she herself in her human form also is seen bearing an olive branch in her hand. When the goddess was thus expressed as the dove with the olive branch, there could be no doubt that the symbol had partly reference to the story of the flood. Remember, like I said, this is all tied right into the flood. But there was much more in the symbol than a mere memorial of the great event. When the deified mother was represented as a dove, that could, what could the meaning of this representation be? Just to identify her with the spirit of grace that brooded dove-like over the deep at the creation for the sculptures in Nineveh, as we have seen the wings and the tail of the dove represented in the third member of the idolatrous Assyrian trinity. Why was air thus identified to Juno? Whose symbol was that of the third person in the Assyrian trinity? Why? Because in Chaldea, the same word which signifies air also signifies, quote, the Holy Ghost, unquote. Thus, when the deified queen, in all her respects, regarded as a veritable woman, was at the same time adored as the incarnation of the Holy Ghost, the spirit of peace and love. In the temple of Hierapolis in Syria, there was a famous statue of the goddess Juno, to which crowds from all quarters flocked to worship. The image of the goddess was richly habited, and on her head was a golden dove, and the golden dove on her head showed plainly who it was supposed to dwell in her, even the spirit of God. Herodotus, from personal knowledge, testifies that in Egypt the queen of heaven was the greatest and most worshipped of all divinities. Where her worship was introduced, it was amazing what fascinating power it exerted. The worship of the goddess mother with the child in her arms continued to be observed in Egypt until Christianity entered. If the gospel had come to power among the mass of the people, the worship of this goddess queen would have been overthrown. With the generality, it came only in name. Instead, therefore, the Babylonian goddess being cast out, in too many cases, her name was only changed. She was called the Virgin Mary, and with her child was worshipped with the same idolatrous feeling as professing Christians, as formerly by open and avowed pagans. The consequence was that when AD 325, the Nicene Council was summoned to condemn the heresy of Arius, who denied the true divinity of Christ. That heresy indeed was committed, but not without the help of men who gave distinct indications of a desire to put the creature on a level with the Creator, to set the Virgin Mother aside by side with her son. So this council that he's talking about in 325, so it actually did a bunch of things. So in the early Christian era, when Christianity was spreading, and we talked about this a lot in the Gnostic episodes, when we were talking about the Gnostics, every like little enclave or every little like tribe or community basically had a different take on it. I mean, they might have been close and they might have been the same, but they were wildly varying outliers. So because the scripture has been changed, and nobody wants to talk about this, because the scripture has been changed, you know, and added to over the years, you know, early Christians had a gigantic fight about whether Jesus was the Messiah, or if he was the Messiah, whether he was divine or was he just a prophet. There were these guys, I can't remember what they were called, but they basically were like, well, maybe Jesus was a hologram. I'm using today's terminology, but that's basically what they were like. Luke in that fucking blasphemous Last Jedi movie at the end, where he just projected his image somehow over like the galaxy. Like, that's what they thought. They were like, well, if Jesus was God, or if Jesus was divine, he could not possibly suffer. So it was just all an illusion. It was a perfect illusion. A perfect illusion. So there was a lot of shit being hashed out at these councils when they would have them. And there were some groups that were like, well, no, Jesus was a dude. But when John baptized him and a dove flew, listen, this dove stuff, there's something to this. And this dove flew at him. That was the Holy Spirit onboarding. And then when he was crucified and the curtains and all that stuff got ripped in the temple, that was the Holy Spirit leaving him, which is why he said, Lord, why do you forsake me? It's because the Holy Spirit had left him. So he was able to suffer. So it's all very fascinating. I imagine, given a long enough timeline, we're going to wind up doing an episode about this. Maybe I'll put it on the schedule now because my imagination is just firing, just talking, just getting into this a little bit. So when you hear about this Council of Nicaea, I think there was one in Constantinople, I don't know, but they would bring all these great thinkers together. And they would be like, all right, bros, let's order some hot wings. Let's drink a couple beers and let's sort this shit out. And a lot of times, not the cooler heads prevailed. A lot of times, the weirdest stuff got put in. I mean, I'm not saying Jesus is a hologram is weirder than Jesus is a God person, boy, or whatever. I'm just saying, like, a lot of weird stuff creeped in. I mean, just look at the fucking communion. That's weird, bro. It's weird. Purgatory, all that stuff. There's no Bible stuff about purgatory. You want to talk about Ash Wednesday, all the fish for lunch and shit? None of that's in the Bible. Mary, the veneration of Mary, the very point of this episode, not in the Bible. You got to check it in your Bible. Don't make me get Pastor Larry Solomon in here to talk to you about the Bible and about hell and Hades and hellfire and brimstone. That joke is not going to pay off for another 3 weeks. Okay. The Council of Nice. That is representation. I'm sorry for that. I know we're running long already, and I just went off on this huge tear, but you get back to it. At the Council of Nice. I don't think it's nice. I think I did a typo. Whatever. There is a representation of the so-called Christianity of Egypt, held that there were three persons in the Trinity, the Father, the Virgin Mary, and Messiah, their son. In reference to this astounding fact elicited from the Nicene Council, there it is, either Hislop or myself had a typo when I was editing. It could be me, but I think it's, I want to go, I need to go order that 7th edition so I can check my shit. Speaks exultingly on these discussions, intending to the glorification of Mary. Thus, the controversy opened a question that it did not settle. It discovered a new sphere, if we may so speak, the realms of light, to which the church had not yet assigned its inhabitants. Thus were the wonder of heaven. A throne was seen far above all created powers, and mediatorially, intersectionally, who did this? A title, archetypal, a crowned bright scepter over all. And who was the predestined heir of all that majesty? Who was the wisdom and Egadi, the rose plant in Jericho, created from the beginning before the world, and the gods' councils in Jerusalem was her power. The vision is found in Apocalypse. We also talked about this. The woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet, and upon her head a crown of 12 stars. That votaries of Mary do not exceed the true faith unless blasphemers of her son came up to it. The Church of Rome is not idolatrous unless Arianism is orthodoxy. This is the very poetry of blasphemy. It continues in argument too, but what does that argument amount to? It amounts to this, that if Christ be admitted as the true and properly God, the worthy of divine honors, his mother from whom he derived merely his humanity must be admitted to be the same, must be raised far above the level of all creatures and be worshipped as the partaker of the Godhead, that the divinity of Christ is made to stand or fall with the divinity of his mother, such as popery in the 19th century, yay, such as popetry in England. It is already known that popery abroad is bold and unblushing in its blasphemies. This the name of blasphemy bestowed on the papacy on Mary have not one shadow of foundation in the Bible. There are all to be found in the Babylonian idolatry. Here we go. I'm ramping up. Are you ready for this? If these things be true, who will venture now to plead for Papal Rome or to call her a Christian church? There is one who fears God and one who reads these lines who would not admit to paganism alone could ever have inspired such a doctrine as that avowed by the Amalekites at the Nicene Council. That the Holy Trinity consisted of a Father, the Virgin Mary, and the Messiah, their Son, as there is one who would not shrink in horror from such a thought. What then would the reader say of a church that teaches its children to adore such a Trinity as that contained in the following lines? Heart of Jesus, I adore thee. Heart of Mary, I implore thee. Heart of Joseph, pure and just. In thee, these three hearts, I put my trust. What every Christian must know and do, by Reverend J. Furness, published by John Duffy in Dublin in the edition of the blah, blah, blah. Blessed be Jesus, Mary, and Joseph. Jesus, Mary, and Joseph give you my heart and my life and my soul. Jesus, Mary, and Joseph assist me always. It is my last agony. Jesus, Mary, and Joseph receive my last breath. Amen. In the morning before you get up, make the sign of the cross and say, Jesus, Mary, and Joseph, I give you my heart and my soul. Each time you say this prayer, you get an indulgence of 100 days, which you can give the souls in purgatory. If this is not paganism, what is there that can be called by such a name? Yet there is the Trinity, which now the Roman Catholics of Ireland from tender infancy are taught to adore. This is the Trinity which the latest books of Catholic instruction are presented as the grand object of devotion to the adherents of the papacy. The manual that contains this blasphemy comes forth with the express imprimatur of Pyles Cohen, Popish Archbishop of Dublin. Will anyone after this say that the Roman Catholic Church must still be called Christian because it holds the doctrine of this Trinity? So did the pagan Babylonians. So did the Egyptians. So do the Hindus at this hour. In the same very sense as which Rome does, admittedly a Trinity, but did they worship the triune Jehovah, the eternal King, the immortal, the invisible? And with anyone say that such evidence before him that Rome does so too? Away then with the deadly delusion that Rome is Christian. The might once might have been a papalation for entertaining such a supposition, but every day the grand mystery is revealing itself and more in its truer character. There is not, there cannot be any safety for souls of men in Babylon. Come out of her, my people, is the loud expressed command of God. Thus, who disobey that command, do it at their peril. I'm John. This has been the Abercast. I'm not even Catholic, but I'm fucking... I love this. I love this show. I love talking to you guys, and I love getting revved up. Okay, rate and review. I'd like to encourage everybody to rate and review on iTunes. Check out the website, stigmatastudios.com. Check out the website, theabercast.com. They're both the same website. Go find my social media links. Let me know what you think about all this. About all this. Is everybody worshiping Nimrod, Sirius, and Tammuz? Is it possible? What do you think about it? I'm super curious to hear how this is falling upon you guys. And some of you guys are probably like, this is old news, whatever. However, it is old news. I this book was written in 1916, for fuck's sake. But it's so well written and researched, you know, and I took a lot of all of the footnotes and all this stuff out of it. But it's super interesting. And think of the ramifications of it. I mean, that's really where we're at, right? Like, let's just accept it and let's look at the ramifications of it. And everybody that's talking about the God and Jesus and the Virgin Mary and even the Holy Ghost, you know, I mean, it's from top down, it gets shady. So I'm going to roll right now. I mean, we are long as fuck. I'm going to roll right now. I want to just remind everybody, if you're in Ohio, Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, if you're in, West Virginia, 1695 Marshall Street, Brentwood, West Virginia. There is, on September 2nd, the Over the Top Battle Royal. I'm making my triumphant return. I'm making my return to the ring to make indie wrestling history. The Guinness Book of World Records. It's the Over the Top Rope Battle Royal with over 100 entrants. I have a little inside information. I think it's 108 entrants. I don't know if I should be talking about that or not. Anyhow, I'm going to be there representing. I'm going to have my Abercast shirt. You can check the website pretty soon. If it's not there now, it will be in the very near future. You'll be able to purchase one if you want. It's got the logo up front. Super sweet. And then it has the oath in back in like striking white against the black t-shirt. So it's really cool. And want to also thank you guys. Thank you so much. I'm curious to hear what you have to say about all this stuff. And then next week we have two awesome episodes. We're finishing up the Greater Key of Solomon stuff. So I'm really happy about that. So, okay, I gotta go. I gotta make taco fucking salad. So this is April's Child by Saturn Machine. The link is in the show notes. They're a British, hold on, how do they say it? They're a new wave occult British psychedelic grunge rock band that creates the sound described as war gaze. That's, I feel like I should spell it. WARGAZE. War gaze. So check them out. Check out their YouTube video and find them on all the social media and give them some love. Let them know that you found them by the show. And, man, I've been recording for like 5 fucking days straight, dudes. I need a break. So stay tuned and listen to this. You fast forward through it if you want, but check out April's Child by Saturn Machine.
Stigmata Studios presents The Scorpion Strikes. In this comic book, a terrorist called the Scorpion is transported to a secret CIA prison. He quickly turns the tables on the guards and administrators and releases the prisoners. A well-armed anarchist called Constituent Zero assembles a team and fights to take the prison back. The story is a dark political action thriller. The Scorpion's actions set the stage perfectly for the Jin Jihad. Available on Indie Planet. Get more info on The Scorpion Strikes, The Jin Jihad, and other titles at stigmatastudios.com. Stigmata Studios presents The Test of the Scorpion. In this comic book, while the Jin Jihad is raging on one side of the city The terrorist, called the Scorpion, sets a secondary attack in motion as he obtains a small tactical nuclear bomb. A mysterious, ever-living warrior called Cyrus the Dead Guy steps forward to test the faith of the Scorpion and his lunatic followers. This is an action-adventure story. It's a bit of swashbuckler that wraps up the Jihad stories. Available on Indie Planet. Get more info on the Scorpion Strikes, the Jin Jihad, the Test of the Scorpion, and other titles at stigmatastudios.com.